Okay, so here is where our final tier list lies. I decided to switch things up a little bit because what's the use of having a category like Dungeon Daddy if I'm not going to stick some daddies in there?
Hi, this is Abraham El Jaguar, a professional game master.
That's when the bash, naughty word, somebody we won't name online will destroy you and your confidence fast if you're new. And we know who he's talking about. There's a guy out there who, you know, likes to critique game sessions and doesn't really know what he's talking about.
Good guts. He's gone into your channel because he's been banned on my channel. So I don't know what you want to do about that, but have fun with that shit.
My name is Paul, and I'll be your DM for a while. I've been playing RPGs for over 30 years and a professional DM as well as a therapeutic game master.
For me, success at the table involves walking away feeling like the players were engaged and having fun.
TTRPG hobbyists appear to have a higher percentage of folks on the autism spectrum.
Now, and so it begins.
And the award for best player goes to Ginny. Really? You deserve it. You're such a great player. I love having you at my table.
Shauner is with us. I believe it's a first-time visit. Pointing out there's actually a player shortage. I don't know about that.
Today's topic is actually going to be talking about opening up the game even wider for people who are neurodivergent on the spectrum. How do we invite them to the table to engage and have a bunch of fun, learn and grow from that?
I've deleted my chill stream channel, Bear the Gen X GM. It's gone because it's not therapy and I'm not here for therapy. I'm here to have fun. And I promise you, the day it stops being fun doing this is the day I delete this channel as well.
And here's the issue. Larry Elmore saying this is a dude, I'm like, no, you don't get to claim that. You didn't do it, right? You drew the back of a warrior. If you wanted to make it clear that it was a man, you could have done exactly what you could have done. And actually, that's just it. Larry Elmore said, right, that Gary Gygax said, the important part thing is that there is, I don't know, he's like, we don't need to define this. They left it undefined, right? Like, and Larry Elmore could have painted and could have went and established the canon he wanted, right? But he drew somebody's back. That's not enough to establish gender. That's not enough to establish gender, right? So he's claiming canon he never achieved, okay?
The characters, here's the dragon itself separated out. Here is sort of the tavern and a couple of the NPCs. Or the PCs, rather, I guess. And there's, again, here's the... Looks like there may be some... Myconoids here, maybe? There's some skeletons. We see the Beholder here. Here's the Displacer Beast. And the Gelatinous Cube. Like I said, I am extremely excited for this LEGO set. I will absolutely be figuring out whatever it takes to become a LEGO Insider. And I'll be doing a live stream over on my Twitch channel building the LEGO set once I actually get it in hand, and maybe getting a chance to run the adventure as well. So,
one of the biggest worries for a game master running a hex crawl campaign is that your players will struggle to know what to do.
What's up, nerds? Just taking a leisurely late afternoon stroll. Pondering things that we ponder when we walk. Tossing out some pearls of wisdom in regards to GM tips, right? Not that I am any way, shape, or form categorically perfect as a DM, but I think I've picked up a thing or two over the past 40 some odd years.
What are the rules for D&D. So I asked some of my friends to join me so we could discuss a little bit. And believe it or not, D&D is probably one of the easiest things to actually get started in because all you need is your imagination.
I have peaked. I ran almost 20,000 gaming sessions. I have ran, you know, if I really, really added up and all the names signed to my thing over the years as a public game master, between 8 and 11,000 players. Since 1991. And I have ran a variety of games, a sort of freestyle game, and my own created from scratch, top to bottom, games. And I'm not just bragging. I worked my ass off. I worked my fucking ass off as a game master to be at the top. I put the time in. I made sacrifices, right? That's how it happened. That's how I got here. And I'm not going to throw that away. And I'm not going to have anyone in the hobby try to belittle me or say, oh, you're not at the top of the mountain, Steven. Oh, fucking rights I am. And when I compare myself to other game masters online, yeah, it's easy. It's easy to know for sure that I'm probably one of the best.
Like, cameras are so essential, in my opinion, to online play. And I can't run a game if people don't have their cameras on, man. Like, I don't know, man. Maybe you're not the most pretty person in the world, but I don't really care. I just want to run a cool game for you. And I need cameras for that.
So I just wanted to take a minute and, like, I'm so in love with this, you know, Lego Dungeons and Dragons, Red Dragon's Tale set. And one of the things that's really been fascinating to me are these doors, right? So I've already done a few videos where I really have been thinking about doors from the perspective of their metaphor. But here, this is a door that literally leads into the dungeon, right? And one of the things that, you know, there's just so much that we're starting to consider, right? So this actually opens up. And you could see, you know, it's very dark in there. And that's, you know, but I love that this door opens and these doors have different parts, right? What does it mean if the frame around the door is brown? What does it mean if the knob is blue rather than gold? If the window is black rather than gold? Fascinating.
While no D&D is better than bad D&D, pretty good D&D is better than no D&D.
I know I'm not going to be invited to any of these games, so I want to run my own. And I don't hold that against you guys. That's just life. I mean, it's perfectly fine to have like an all-male space, and that's why I have to create my own.
That would be the end of everything. If I showed up and I was like, oh yeah, guys, hey guys, I'm running game Thursday night. That's cool, right? They're like, yep, okay, see you there. 5 minutes into the session. Yeah, guys, I invited Harmony.
No, like, that would be so weird. Do you know how uncomfortable that would be for me? Like, to show up to a game with like 8 dudes and I don't want that. I have 2 other girls in my game. Like, and we have a mixed sex game. You guys don't. And that's perfectly cool. You know, that's why I had to create my own, if that makes sense.
No way. Absolutely not.
And I'm good with that. Don't worry. I don't want Hunger Games. Like I said, it would be an equally uncomfortable experience for me. No.
Shauner's with us. Says they're not looking for actors. Says they look for proactive players that role play in character. That's not something that I ask people to do. Although it is kind of funny that you will get players, especially people who are relatively new to the hobby, who will sit there and be like, my character does this, blah, blah, blah. And then after a while, they're like, okay, so I'm going to go. So I say this. And I always get a kick out of seeing people kind of, strangely enough, this is probably an odd word to use, bloom as a player at your game table. I always think that's kind of cool.
Here's some other advice. You can still use the railroad, right? Like if you plotted out a railroad and that's what you feel comfortable with, the players don't know that like what's in the right room is in the left room. If they go off far to the left, it could still be what's on the right, you know? Like, so, I give that advice to player new GMs all the time.
You are watching the Shauner channel, host of Traveler, Python, CG, Skyrim, and Bikini videos.
Hey, Sushan, I was watching this video. This guy, I don't know, he makes this one claim I'm against. And then he doubles down and he layers another claim on that, which is a total fail for me. Let's rewind. This is the GM philosopher.
Hello friends and welcome back to my channel. Today we are talking about 3 D&D GM mistakes to avoid at all costs. And let me tell you something, I learned these the hard way GMing my own games. I've had a really good track record of having great players who give me good feedback. And these are the three things that earlier on in my GMing experience, no matter how much I tried to do them, no matter how much I tried to make them work, I always got bad feedback about them. And when I abandoned them altogether, my players ended up so much happier. And some of these things are a little tempting to do, and for good reason. And some GMs, they get a little bit lost in the journey of trying to figure out how to manage these things. So we're going to talk about all three of them today. All three, starting with number one, taking away player agency. What is player agency? It's the player's ability to make choices, try things, and interact with the world. Now, this mistake can be likened to violating the existential principle of autonomy, where individuals are seen as free agents capable of determining their own destiny. In D&D, when a GM takes away player agency, they strip players of their existential right to craft their own narrative. This not only diminishes the game's engagement, but also disempowers players, turning what could be a dynamic adventure into a passive experience where players feel more like observers than active participants. And this.
He just described 99% of the games that are out there. It gets worse.
This is most likely to happen when it's tied to a plot element. So for example, like let's say the players are standing in a room having a conversation with an important diplomat, and suddenly one of them draws their bow and wants to shoot him. You might think this is disastrous for my plot. However, it's really important.
The GM would probably want to vet that player first. I mean, was it building up to that scene where the player wants to shoot an arrow into some NPC? Or was it just out of the clear blue? The player just announces, I'm going to shoot him. Just, you know, out of the blue. No warning or anything. How did it get to that point where the player decides to kill an NPC? Oftentimes it's just you invited the wrong player to your game. You didn't vet them. You know, the player you invited just likes to kill NPCs. It happens. That's why you vet your players. But then he adds this one other thing to it, which I thought was bizarre.
Important to understand that not giving players the chance to take the actions that they want to take can really hurt the game experience for them, because players play role-playing games because they want to enact their character's story upon your.
Is that true? Role players want to enact their story upon the GM's story?
Or amazing world. And
you know, like the last I checked, the good role players don't have a story for their character. I can't even imagine a game where the GM is trying to tell a story to his players who are very passive. They just sit there and listen. They don't participate in the game. Happens all the time. I see it every day on YouTube. But then the players that are passive, that are just sitting there, they actually wanted to do their player's story in this GM's world. Like, you got two kinds of players playing different games in your game session. Aren't there social contracts? I use a social contract. Aren't there social contracts in this day and age where the GMs and the players decide how the game's going to work? What the players are going to be expected to do or not expected to do, or the GM's expected to do, or instead of just inviting randos to your table and they're thinking they're going to be acting out their character's story in your game world, but then they find out, oh no, once again, the GM's going to have me sit here in a chair and be quiet while he tells me a story about how amazing my character is. I don't get to say what my character does. So you got two different kinds of players trying to do the same game together without, you know, go to Discord and say, hey, how do you run your games? And then the GM says, hey, how do you roll your players? You know, that kind of thing. That doesn't get talked about. It's like, oh, you like D&D? I like D&D. We're friends. Come on in.
Those ingredients are both needed to create an immersive experience. And so we don't want to stifle that agency. And that leaves me to my second point. The second mistake, the second biggest mistake that I've learned can really derail your D&D game is trying to force the plot onto your players at the expense of their freedom to design their own destiny and in-game experience. And this is very much goes hand in hand with the
That goes with the first one. I don't think Dungeon Masters learn from this, to be honest. I think they just keep repeating the same mistakes. They ask the players at the end of the game, so, what do you think? And the players just smile and nod and say, that was fun. Which means shit. It means fun means shit. Doesn't tell the GM anything.
First tip. Imposing a rigid plot structure can be viewed through the lens of philosophical authoritarianism, where freedom is sacrificed for the sake of order. Now, we all know that sometimes when players are left to their own devices and they're allowed to do anything they want.
That's why you vet your players first. Otherwise, you have gonzo players in your game. Who wants that? You're trying to do a consistent world building thing. Your players are trying to do consistent in-character role play. Things that would make sense in the game setting that their characters would do. And then you have the players that just want to randomly kill stuff. You know, their character sheet is their scorecard.
Things can get crazy and chaotic, right? So there do have to be consequences for kind of like crazy behavior in your game world, because in your game world, there are probably things like laws. There are probably things like social norms, ethics, customs, right? People who violate them are going to suffer some kind of...
Hey, most Democrats don't know how governments even work. So how are they going to roleplay in a fantasy world? They don't even know how the real world works.
A detrimental downside, perhaps getting shunned, getting arrested, that kind of thing. However, trying to force players to follow your plot or obey these customs out of game, or by like restricting their character's abilities to even roll dice and try things.
Yeah, Heathen Dog ran a Call of Cthulhu game. And he role-played all the player characters in the game. He also rolled the dice for the players in the game. I don't even know what the players were there in the game for. To tell jokes, maybe? They weren't playing Call of Cthulhu. Heathen Dog was. What were they in the stream for? I don't know.
This can really hurt the game experience for players. And once again, it makes them feel very stifled, right? Just as in philosophy, where this approach is critiqued for stifling individuality and creativity, in D&D, such rigidity can prevent the organic development of a story shaped by players' choices. This undermines the collaborative nature of role.
I mean, there's also the problem that probably happens thousands of times a day, where a player... is invited to a D&D game. And the player's been told that D&D is a role-playing game. You're only limited by your own imagination. That kind of nonsense. You know, make your character and show up, and you get to role-play that character, and you're going to have an exciting time. You're going to be on an adventure, yada, yada, yada. So the player's totally psyched about it. This, you know, it could be their first time in a D&D game. They're expecting roleplay to be in the game session. But what happens? What happens 99% of the time? They find out that it's 4 hours of just a long, hard slog of combat in a hallway between two rooms. We're gonna The next 4-hour session is going to take place doing combat in the next room. That's too slow. And the players are too nice to say, hey, this isn't role play. We're just playing a board game. I didn't know I was going to be invited to a board game. I wanted to role play. But the players are too nice to say that. They might show up again for a second session, a third session. They give up on the role play and they just do the passive play where the GM keeps asking them, what do you do? What do you do? You're being attacked. What do you do? And the player just says, I attack. Every time it's the player's turn, he says, I'm going to attack whoever's near me. Whoever's the closest to me, I'll attack. And for the remainder of this 4-hour game session, I'll just be attacking every time it's my turn at anything that comes near me. That's putting your character on autopilot. Now imagine if, you know, the other 4 players do the same thing. They just put their player characters on autopilot for a 4-hour combat session. Now the GM has to do all the combat, figuring out the DMs to add, subtract from the die rolls, that kind of thing, for the players, because they've all said what they're going to do for the remainder of the game, basically. I mean, can't they just fast forward that? Just make one single roll from each player to see how well they did on average for that 4-hour combat, and then just go to the next thing to do. Leave the hallway and go to another part of the castle. You know, you're supposed to be doing something. You have a goal in this game, right? Why were you even in the castle in the first place? But no, we're stuck in this hallway. Spirit ghosts in front of us. Zombies behind us. You know, that kind of thing. Oh, now we hear werewolves in the next room ahead. Oh, great. It's like a funhouse. We're in a fucking funhouse that's stalled. The ride has stalled. And we're stuck in the hallway.
Playing, turning the game into a pre-scripted narrative with limited player impact. And let me just tell you this, let me offer you a little bit of encouragement today. Sometimes the wildest, best, craziest, most memorable things that I've ever experienced in my own D&D games came from me letting a player do something that originally I thought to myself, oh my goodness, this is going to derail everything. But it turned out that when I took...
He said, derail everything. So this guy's a railroader. This guy here, this GM philosopher, he railroads his players. So he's constantly worried that his game will get derailed by the players. This is why we have problems in the hobby with the crappiest game sessions, the crappiest players. I used to call these guys crap role players. Now I just call them crap players. They don't even try to do the role play. The role play is non-existent in their games. They're playing a role-playing game with no role play in it. When you ask these guys about it, they get all mad. Of course it's a role-playing game. It says so in the title, on the cover of the box. Role-playing game. Or they'll emphasize the game part. It's a game. It's just a game. It's a role-playing game. What's your problem? What part don't you understand about game? We're playing a game. This is what they do. These guys all fall back on that when they realize that they're crap players. Crap GMs, crap DMs. It's like, take your motivational speaking ass life coach fucking ass out of the hobby. Get the fuck out of the hobby. Let players... This is what you do. This is what you do. The players all have the same idea, right? When they sign up for this stuff, they're going to be role-playing a character. They believed what the marketing said about the game. So they show up to do what the marketing said the game can do. The players should show up without a GM or a DM. And from that group, they should pick, or someone should say, who will be the GM for this game? And they do a little session zero together, finding out what this, what the world setting is going to be, what the goals, the themes, the motives, the mood, the scope of the game. You know, don't do the 5-year campaign nonsense. Just play a few games of whatever it is you signed up for. Don't waste your life with a 5-year campaign with somebody who's just a crap player in the hobby. You know, find players that are motivated, enthusiastic, they want to play the game. And in that group is where a DM or GM gets voted on or signed up on. Usually it's whoever has the books is the Dungeon Master. And you just pray. You just pray that as a player, that the person you voted for to run the game can run the game. You know, you hope to God it's not like voting for a Republican, right? The Republican says, they're going to fix the country and vote for me and I'll, you know. So you vote for a Republican, right? This has been going on for like 40 years. You vote for a Republican. What happens? The Republican turns into a Democrat the moment they're elected. It's like, God damn it.
Took that as fuel for creativity and then turned that into a real ingredient or building block for my plot. And I made it work together with it and I made it real. And it just like, I went with it and I invested in it. They became such incredible, memorable experiences. Like, you know how players get, they do crazy things. And sometimes those crazy things can lead to the most memorable outcomes. And that leads us to our third and final point.
How about just vet your players, get better players, and then you have better memories instead of the gonzo things that happen.
Right. The third thing that can ruin any D&D game, not allowing your players to do cool stuff that perhaps doesn't technically work with the rules as written. We all know a couple of players like this, don't we? Prohibiting players from performing actions that don't align with the rules as written can be analogous to legal positivism in philosophy.
Well, do a practice session. If this player really wants to be in your game, do a practice session. See if they can play the game. See if they can follow the rules of the game when it's their turn, especially when it comes to skills. If the player is talking for 5 minutes about what he's going to do for the next half hour to an hour in the game, that's just kick that player. You want a player who's going to say, when you ask them, what do you do? You know, if this is the style you play, when you say, what do you do? Actually, saying, what do you do? It's better to say, if you're going to ask, you might as well say, what are you doing? Because you have to know right now what the player is doing. Not what they're gonna do, not what they will do, not what they want to do, not what they wish they can do. What are they doing right now? So the player has to just say what their character is doing right now. Right now. Not what they're gonna do. And the player needs to practice doing that until they... It takes like, what, 15, 20 minutes to practice that? And then the player has it. You know, they can do it, muscle memory. They can just do it without thinking. When it's their turn, they just say what they're doing at that moment. Instead of, well, I'm gonna do this sneak maneuver thing. I'm gonna backstab this person, and then I'm gonna use my other weapon to steal the soul from the king's bride to be blah blah blah, and I have this magical thing that I'll use to teleport my way out of here. Well, I was like, okay, that's a bit much for your turn right now. What are you doing right now, though? Let's assume that you finished tying your shoes. What are you doing right now? Or, you know, for the next 12 seconds, what will you be doing? What can you do in 12 seconds in this game? You know, reload a pistol. Put the rest of your armor on. That's what you've been trying to do, but you keep getting interrupted by the chambermaid. Like, that person's basically saying they're putting their armor on. So they're... We just skip them. We'll skip them for a while, because it takes a while to put armor on. It's not like in Skyrim where you just click on the things you want to wear and poof, you're ready. No, it takes a while. Sometimes it takes help getting your armor on. Maybe off too, who knows? Anyway, what else is he talking about?
Philosophy, which upholds laws without regard for their fairness or moral value. In D&D, this approach can stifle creativity and fun, which are two central pillars of the game. Allowing cool stuff, even if it bends the rules, enhances the magical aspect of role-playing, fostering a sense of wonder and possibility.
Wait, if a player wants to play a cool game as a cool player, they should play a different game. What are they playing D&D for? For God's sakes.
...that keeps the spirit of adventure alive. I am very... happy and grateful to have been blessed with role-playing friends who think of all kinds of wild things to try that are not written in the rules. And generally speaking, I go with the idea of if they want to try to do it, they can. I just have to figure out how difficult it'll be to succeed. And it might be a high check, but okay, you know, they're going to get the chance to do it because I want to give them the chance to try their cool thing. And you know what? They might roll a nat 20 on something that seems literally impossible and pull it off. Even if it's not actually possible, giving them some kind of stepping.
I like die mechanics where something seems impossible to do because it is impossible to do. In D&D, I don't know if there is an impossible thing to do. Oh, I rolled a 20, so I guess I invent time travel on my turn. And what the hell is that? Like, I'm a scientist. I'm going to invent time travel on my turn. And then you roll and you hope for a 20. What the fuck? What the fuck game system is that?
Stone building blocks to try to make it possible. For example, you can't just cast wish. You can't just cast the wish spell in a vacuum with no previous magical training. However, if a player is so dead set on casting the wish spell, maybe I'll say, you know what, roll a history check. You know, you have heard that there have been people in history who have managed to do this, and they had to kind of do these things, blah blah blah, right? So maybe I'll craft a little something in the storyline to empower a player.
How about instead of letting them do the wish thing as a wish thing that they don't have or don't know how to do, have them try practicing a wish thing. Have them try doing the practice for learning how to do the wish thing. You know, do the work. Have the player do the work.
Player to at least show them, hey, what you want to do is really like powerful, maybe not possible right now, but it could be possible. Here's a storyline, here's a quest to make it happen. You don't just have to go by the literal rules in the book, you know, to do every single thing. So this can make a game very open-ended and very fun, as long as you kind of, in good classic GM style, maintain a bit of order and you make sure that things don't get too wacky and out of control so that you can maintain that real sense of...
Classic GM style, where the GM tries to... keeps the players from going too wacky in the game session. And hilarity ensues. Is that classic? Is that classic GMing? Or is that just crap GMing? That's just your standard crap GM, right? For almost 50 years. It's like, why do people insist on doing mistakes over and over and over again? Why are these D&D players? They don't want to learn from other people's past mistakes. They just want to... They think... I don't know. It's just dumb. People repeating the same mistakes all the time. Over and over and over again. Like the kid wants to learn how to ride a bike, but for whatever reason can never learn how to ride the bike. They just keep falling off the bike. The bike keeps tipping over. They never figure out how to ride a bike. That's how Dungeons & Dragons is. These players never figure out how to play the fucking game. They've been in it for decades. And every time it's their turn, they act like it's their fucking first turn time ever rolling dice. And they roll a number, and all they do is say what the number is. They don't even begin to say what their character does after their roll. They wait for the GM to tell them what their character does. Because they're for 40-something decade, you know, 40 years, they've been letting the GM role-play their characters for them. What have you've been wasting your life for 40 years sitting at a table, just nodding and smiling whenever the GM says something awesome that your character does. And you're like, yeah! And you think you're part of that? You think you're part of the game? Just because you made a roll? You got to roll a die during the game? Man, this is just perverse. The more I think about it, D&D is just a perverse hobby for some. It just is. The GMs get their weird little, you know, sycophants showing up every week to roll dice. It's just bizarre to me.
Of reality immersion, right? You want the players to have that sense of feeling like this obviously is a fantasy world, but it is believable, right? It's believable enough that it matters to them and it seems real enough that they care about it. And that's really, once you accomplish that, you've got it made.
They'll believe whatever comes out of the GM's mouth about their character. Because what does the player know? The player knows nothing about the world. They're just showing up to have fun, I guess. And as long as everyone's having fun, at least, the bare minimum is fun, then I guess the GM did their job right.
So there you go. There's my three tips. Thank you so much for coming by. And I just want to congratulate you, give you a little encouragement.
No, no, thank you. No, thank you.